Okay, now let's take a look at Spearman's correlation. Spearman's correlation is very commonly referred to as Spearman's rank order correlation. Now, Spearman's correlation is really nothing more than Pearson's correlation, but we're going to compute it on the ranks of the data. As such, we can actually apply this to ordinal data, whereas Pearson's, you really need to apply it to only interval or ratio data. Now, Spearman's correlation is actually a measurement of monotonic association, whereas Pearson's very specifically was a measurement of linear association. Let's take a look at a couple of diagrams and see what the difference is. Okay, monotonic, something that's monotonic, basically what that means is mono, one, has one behavior. So what we are looking for is monotonic increasing or monotonic decreasing. Obviously, linear association would also be monotonic because it's only going in one direction. But if it's curved but consistent, then we refer to it as being monotonic. So something that's monotonic increasing could look like this. See, if I draw a line around this, what I'm seeing is something that has some curvature to it. But the curvature is consistent. It's constantly getting larger. Another obvious increase, monotonic increasing, will look perhaps something like this. Again, there's curvature to it, but it's constantly increasing. Monotonic decreasing would be something like this. When I briefly or just quickly and easily draw a line around it, this is what I'm seeing. There's curvature to it, but it's always decreasing. Or the last option would be something like this. There's clearly curvature, but it's always decreasing. If it's going up and down, for this course, we're in trouble. It's all over. There's not much that we can do with it. So when we talk about monotonicity, that's what we're actually referring to. Does the data appear to be monotonic? Monotonic increasing or monotonic decreasing? Now, to go back to notation, as you recall, Pearson's correlation, we use the Greek letter rho and a statistic r, and the r is a measurement of the strength of the linear association. And just as a quick review, for Spearman's correlation, we use the Greek letter rho with a subscript of s, and the statistic is r with a subscript of s, and that's the strength of the monotonic association. Now, as I said a few moments ago, in reality, linear association is also monotonic. Let's come back to this real quick. We'll clear this screen. Clearly, something that is linear increasing, this is definitely monotonic. However, we want to use Pearson's. This is just like the idea of the empirical rule or Chebyshev's rule. If the data is mound shape, approximately normal, the empirical rule does a better job. Chebyshev fits everything else. So we think of Spearman's in the same light, that Spearman's is a non-parametric technique that we can use on monotonic data, something that's curved but not linear. If it's linear, yes, Spearman's will work, but Pearson's will do a better job. So Pearson's is the right tool to use. Okay, let's take a look at an example. Go ahead and enter this data in your calculator. And if you're going to follow me, again, I used L1 for sugar and L2 for cavities. Again, the child, just like the year for the Finger Lakes data, the child here is just the individual child. We're not really using this as data. It's just more of an identifier. So if you want to follow me keystroke by keystroke, go ahead and enter this data, pause the presentation, enter this data, and then come back and we'll keep going. Okay, I'm assuming that you went ahead and you do have the data in there. Now let's take a look at this data. A dental hygienist conducts research regarding or recording the ounces of sugar consumed weekly and the number of cavities observed among 12-year-old children. Is there evidence to suggest a relationship between sugar consumed weekly and the number of cavities? Now, the first thing we want to do is produce a scatter plot and decide if there appears to be a linear or monotonic trend. Obviously, if it looks to be linear, then we go ahead and use Pearson's. If it's nonlinear but monotonic, then we consider Spearman's. So, I'm going to go ahead and bring up my calculator. And let's jump right straight to the scatter plot. Second, stat plot. I'll use stat plot 1. Move this over just a little bit. There we go. Let's see. There's my scatter plot. I need L1 and then L2. And I will zoom 9. And what I'm seeing here is something with curvature to it. There's definitely a banana shape sort of a thing going on here. So I'm going ahead and I will draw that real quickly on my page here. Let's see. Basically, my scatter plot's looking something like, let me get a little bit of detail here. All right, something like this, this sort of a thing. And what I'm seeing is curvature. It's monotonic, so this is suggesting that Spearman's correlation would be the appropriate route to take. Now, this is what Spearman's actually does. It actually takes the raw data and converts it to ranks. So, in terms of ranks, see the 0, this would be rank 1, that's the smallest. The 1 would be rank 2, that's the biggest. 4, that would be rank 3. The 9 would be rank 4, 13 would be rank 5, and 22 would be rank 6. If I were to sort the data, that's the order that the numbers would come in. But don't sort it. We need to keep them paired with the original or paired with the cavities. See, cavities, 0 is the smallest, 5 is the next one, 6 is the next, 8 is the next one, and then 9 is the 5th rank, and 10 is the 6th rank. Now, what happens is, Spearman's actually looks at the ranks of the data. And let's do that real quickly. Go ahead and enter that. I have this in L3, and this one in L4. I already put them in. If you want to pause the presentation for a second and go ahead and do that, because we will take a look and see what happens when we transfer the data to ranks and then plot the ranks. So back here, I'm going to go second, stat plot, option 1. And this is now L3 and L4. Zoom 9. See, that's extremely linear now. So that's what I mean, or that's why Spearman's actually works. It takes the ranks of the data, and the ranks gets rid of that curvature, and we get something much more, linear. And if it's linear, we can do Pearson's. Okay, so now that I know I can do that, I could actually do Pearson's correlation on the ranks. But there's a program in your calculator that we can use. So, let's go ahead and see, go to program. And the program is SR Core. There it is, SR Core for Spearman's correlation. Select it, run it. Group X, where's that? Well, that's my L1 data. And group Y, that's my L2 data. Hit enter. And this is saying that the Spearman's correlation is 0.9429. Okay, so, see, I'm going to make a note, 9429. That's what it came out to be. All right, now, 9429. So we went ahead, we calculated it using the program SR Core, or you could use, if you actually change the ranks by hand, if you use LinReg t-test, you actually get the same correlation. But there's no reason to change it by hand, then go to LinReg t-test, like we did for Pearson's. There we go. I would just go to SR Core and let the calculator handle the rankings for you. Okay, so now we have this correlation. The question is this statistically significant? So we need to run a hypothesis test. We need a hypothesis test for this. All right, so the null hypothesis would be rho sub s equals 0, and the alternative hypothesis would be rho sub s is greater than 0. And again, I'm going to set alpha at 0.5. Now, we actually use a t-test statistic, and this is actually the test statistic if you want to calculate it by hand. It's just the value of the correlation times the square root of n, the sample size minus 2, divided by the square root of 1 minus r squared. And the degrees of freedom is n minus 2. And then in your calculator, you could go to the t distribution CDF, and with this syntax, actually go ahead and do the t-test, get a p-value. But there's also a program called t-test-row that you can run. Now, the program t-test-row really doesn't care if you're using Spearman's or Pearson's correlation. It makes no difference because the input, matter of fact, this equation right here makes no difference. It doesn't know if you're using Pearson's or Spearman's. So you could do this by hand using this method. But let's go to the calculator and run t-test-row. So program, t-test-row, select it, run it. Now, correlation was 0.9429, if I recall correctly, 9429. And now it's going to ask for n. There were six pairs. There's total 12 data points, but there were six pairs, so n equals 6. And now it's going to ask for the alternative hypothesis. We're suspecting positive. And there's a p-value, 0.002. So my p-value is 0.002. My decision would then be to reject the null hypothesis. And the conclusion is that there is evidence to suggest that I'm going to say sugar and number of cavities, I'm going to say, have a positive association. Now, positive, it does not mean good. It simply means the correlation is positive. As one increases, what we see happening is the other increases. Okay, that's really all there is to a Spearman's correlation. And in the next video, I believe we're going to start taking a look at actually building some regression models.